So today's topic is is a new topic, desirability, talked about widely. I was really grappling with this subject. I wanted to learn more about what is desirability and how do we enhance it, and then arrived at this concept, right? Arrived at five considerations that could help us win digital initiatives. I know most organizations are investing heavily on digital initiatives. And I believe this session will help us kind of consolidate our thoughts, understand what it is. And at least in some of you, it triggers the movement to pursue this and develop it further. I would be very happy about. So today we have a very crisp agenda. Begin with setting the context for about 2 or 3 minutes. Then we will get into five considerations, one after the other. And I'll be interleaving interesting case studies in between. So we get to see case studies very early in the session and discuss those, and also conclude with some of the thoughts on how we can take things further. And regarding questions and answers, feel free to put questions on the chat window. Our anchor will help me with the questions, prompt me. If there are some immediate questions to be taken, I would be happy to get interrupted and answer those questions. If some questions can wait till the end, we can do that at the end also. So with that note, a quick check. I wanted to just validate if all of you are able to hear me very clearly. Please confirm. You can just put a yes on the chat window. Okay. Thank you, Rob. Thank you, Ankit. Thank you, Brian. Kokila, Vinay Kumar. Excellent. Very good. Let's take this forward. So desirability, it emanates with the customer obsession, right? How much are we obsessed with customer? So read this, right? COVID really challenged us, and the boon was the way we had the advancements in computing and networking that saved many jobs, that helped us continue services to many of our customers. However, we have come to an understanding that organization must be fanatical about experiences, because even as of now, in many geographies, many countries, people are constrained or people are scared to go out and interact and have the real shopping experience or any other experience for that matter. They are depending on the digital, right? So which means that among the end users, they are becoming more and more tech savvy, and also their expectations are increasing. They are using more and more cool products. They are no longer being serviced by the front end operator. They themselves are becoming digital users. So in order to win such customers, it requires mastery of human design thinking. So we need to think through what they really want, right? And also create compelling user interfaces, interaction design. Equally focus on functional and non-functional requirements. In other words, it's not a typical agile way of working where we take the backlog, we process and deliver sprint on sprint and measure velocity and take products into production. We need to start thinking from that angle as well. And that is what is going to drive business differentiation and results. And those who do it are going to be in the business and win customers. And with that note, let us now move forward, right? What do you see in this picture, right? A picture can speak 1,000 words. And this is an interesting picture. People are sitting together, they are engrossed, not necessarily as individuals. You can see a couple of them kind of together, right? They're passing some kind of feedback, or they're showing some kind of curiosity. And probably there is some kind of element of desirability in what they're doing with their systems or applications. So I would like to put forward the introductory or the definition, right? That desirability is what helps users bond continuously. with the product or service and exult in what they perceive to be a worthy experience. They rejoice. They really feel happy about it. They feel happy about doing it and talking about it or influencing their peers to try it out. That is what is desirable, right? It is nothing mathematical, and there is very little science behind it so far. Even though companies have experimented it, even though they have, even as early as 1970s or 80s, Microsoft conducted studies on how to measure or how to infer desirability in some of their products. So these things happen in some of the product companies, but it's still an intuitive, a new kind of a field where people are researching and trying to figure out how to enhance it. So it's about bonding continuously. It's about people feeling that, hey, it's what an experience worth going through. And that is where it differentiates itself. And it's not about usability, right? Usability is the starting point. You can say it's about best in class usability, which ensures two things, right? Effectiveness, efficiency, resulting in satisfaction. And when it happens, it also enhances the power of desirability, right? It provides foundation, it enhances the power of desirability. And when desirability comes into play, it delivers meaningful, enjoyable, memorable experience. Right? This is what is required in many of the digital initiatives and digital products that companies are launching and working on. Without that, products are going to suffer. Products are going to have delayed adoption or failure or need for a complete uplift. So let me stop here and share an experience with you. A couple of years ago, a large customer came to us and wanted to build a platform for virtual health. Right? Virtual health platform, which typically means that they want to serve members by providing a virtual health app. Not a new idea, right? It's an idea which was tried and tested. This customer came to us after two or three failed attempts. And in every attempt, it was a question of usability, rigor, timely completion, the ability to solve the customer's problem directly and succeed in the project. That's when we took and completed the project very well. It is continuing, and we have more than 3 million users and opportunity for new channels of revenue. This is an example of how things can turn around, right? When you focus on desirability. Here is another example, right? A communication provider, they had a large base of employees, close to 7,000 employees across different states, and wanted to really automate or digitalize services through a portal. It was not working well, even though the portal had strong engineering background, right? Very, very robust architecture, state-of-the-art design patterns and reusable components and so on. We went and we figured out, we did a study to say that, hey, there are some gaps in human-centric design, right? It is not looking at what really the customer wants, how they want to really engage with the system, right? That element is missing. It is not sufficient if we have bright architects and designers who can build a solid foundation or a backbone for the system. That is equally important. And in addition, they need to pay attention to how to attract, right? How to engage end users towards the system. So we went, did human-centric design, because in the erstwhile system, the experience was not consistent. So different components, different subsystems used to have different kind of user interfaces, behave differently, and different kind of exception management and error messaging. We brought in consistency along with innovative and intuitive experience for end users. So that resulted in more than 80% user adoption. That's what our customer wanted. And also this continues to serve more than 7,000 employees. So this is an example of how there are applications, there are systems suffering due to lack of desirability, right? Ability to reach out to the customer, engage them continuously so that they, an actively engaged customer becomes an indirect marketing person who can talk about it and influence additional users to use and adopt, instead of user who either directly or indirectly shares a negative experience with others, thereby influencing others not to use your systems actively, right? So that's what matters. So this is one interesting experience we wanted to share. And also at the end of every such case studies, I put a PDF link you can go through at a later stage, which has all the details. And feel free to reach out to me, right? And any questions. So in essence, right, fanatical devotion, right? There's what we call it, end user or customer obsession. So devotion to desirability leads to tangible outcomes. It's not a cosmetic call. It is not a fancy thing. It's not a fad. It has tangible outcomes. For example, increase in terms of customer retention, increase in terms of revenue growth. These are proven by industry reports or articles. I have shared a couple of them in the footnote. One is from McKinsey and the other is from Forrester, where they claim that according to their experience and their study, fanatical devotion to customer experience and desirability results in tangible outcomes. In other words, teams that are involved, typically cross-functional teams, agile teams, engineering teams, or teams that follow agile and DevOps principles, they need to seed this thought in their mind and see sprint after sprint, release after release, how are we faring in terms of the ability to engage with the customer, right? Are the features or the stories we are delivering really getting that kind of rave reviews and great comments, right? Great observations from end users. And what can we do about it? Because they are the ones who can make the difference. They are the ones who can ask such questions and trigger business analysts, product owner, or product manager to bring the perspective in place to move in that direction. And obviously, digital is creating new business opportunities. It's not just about modernizing existing systems. It's about new business models, new business opportunities. At the same time, it is presenting a lot of challenges and risks to IT executives, right? There are a lot of questions in their mind. So here are some questions. These are really top of mind questions, right? Hey, what makes digital products go viral? Why do some products go viral and why do some products don't? And what are the critical success factors? How can we make digital business thrive? And finally, if we are transforming existing systems, monolithic systems that are resulting in certain revenue and certain customer stickiness in the current business model, and if we modernize, are we going to retain that? Are we going to exceed that? How is it going to be possible, right? How can we make it happen? And what do we need to do? So these are the top questions in people's mind. And in a way, the topic of today's session addresses these questions. And a very solid example, which all of us can relate, right? Why do we see Android phones and iPhones as most desirable phones, right? There are so many phones that came into industry vanished. And here are the reasons, right? One key reason is the richness of feature and how frequently these features became available to end users and hooked them together, right? Communications, different ways of communications. You can have voice, video, you can have other means, right? Asynchronous, for example, WhatsApp or Telegram and so on. And then entertainment. You can watch short videos, long videos, as per your likes or dislikes. It can be about history, it can be about politics, it can be about education, anything else, and information services. You have news, dictionary, thesaurus, etc. And utilities, you have calculator, clock, and so on, a high density camera, and access to payment solutions. You can access your bank account, you can have payment solutions in place, you can book tickets, you can book hotel rooms. And all these with intuitive interfaces, right? People can quickly adopt and learn how things work, and very slick packaging, upgrades of new versions, all happening in a timely manner. You go to bed one day, wake up the next day, you find that an upgrade has automatically happened and there are some cool features, cool icons, you're happy about it. And interestingly, a study was done, it's found that customers are using their devices quarter of their waking time. This is on the average, right? And you may even know that some of the busy users, how frequently they are using their devices. It is because these devices have become the most desirable devices, the way they engage. They help a device helping a human being connect with other human beings with purpose, with their distant friends, relatives, with their banks, their retail stores, and so on, and get tangible outcomes at regular intervals. And yes, definitely there will be some cons also, right? Some disadvantages also. But overall, this technology, these devices have made a stark difference, and stand out as great examples. Now, this is the statement, right? Whether your organization creates and delivers new products and applications or modernizes existing ones, one thing is clear, right? It is you have to deliver an outstanding digital experience, and enhancing desirability is essential. So you cannot escape it. It is a must. You cannot ignore it. The more the attention you pay to this, the more the rewards, right? The more the success is going to, you are going to see more success in the engagements you execute. So any quick questions so far? We can quickly get into any questions. Oh, okay.
Yeah, I don't see at the moment any questions.
No problem. Let's move on, right? So this kind of establishes the context that, yes, this is what desirability is, and this is why it is important. We already looked at a case study, right? Now it's more about what are those five considerations? Can we look at it? So under each five consideration, you're going to see four how-tos or four actions you can take solidly and follow through in your projects. The first one is empathy and experimentation, right? It's not just about executing what comes into your backlog. It's about empathy and experimentation. It's about understanding what the customer wants, understanding the big picture. Practicing human-centric design, even product owners or product managers going and staying with the customer, observing the customer to understand their day-to-day problems and empathizing. And performing design thinking workshops, design sprints, and so on. And also pilots to gather insights on UX and usability. It is not an afterthought. So it's worth running design sprints, it's worth to run pilots to experiment, right? What kind of user experience really excites the user or engages with the user versus what kind of user experience is withdrawing the user from the product. It is more than usability, right? Usability is a sufficient criteria. Okay, it is usable. People can accept it. It's more about how much you can accept or tolerate than how much you can engage and attract, right? So that is the difference. And also continuous experiment. It's not just running sprint after sprint. Are we doing continuous experiments to enhance desirability, right? Or are we moving in that direction? Or are we focusing most of our time in internal struggles of wireframes getting changed or design getting changed and all the software core engineering related issues? Those are important. Are those taking most of our time? Are we really forgetting about this important phenomena? That is what it is, right? Empathy and experimentation. Important consideration, which I don't think it happens in all modern projects where you're adopting Agile and DevOps, because once you get into the core of things, it's all about execution, more features, technical user stories, performance, scalability, and so on. So I would draw your attention to pay more focus on this area. And we will look at one more before we jump into a case study. This is about being fast, frequent, and predictable. It's not important if you're fast. It's not adequate if you're fast. It is not adequate if you're frequent. You have to be predictable. That's important. And it's about being hyper-agile, DevOps, and bringing the engineering rigor. so that you move beyond ceremonies and bring outcomes, right? Move beyond ceremonies, implement engineering practices and bring in outcomes, and also use tools effectively for to increase productivity, because this is about moving fast, right? Tools are going to help you move faster. Implementation of tools cannot be an afterthought, right? If a project, agile project or a program is going to think about tools and alter tools after 3 months or 6 months, it's moving in the wrong direction. It's good to set the platforms right at the beginning, and extensible and flexible architecture, right? Having an architecture which is extensible and flexible is going to reduce rework. It is going to reduce the bandwidth we spend in technical discussions and other project management related discussions. It will help give us some bandwidth to think about user experience and desirability. And finally, reusable patterns and components. How do we design our systems in such a way that we really have, lip service, we take it beyond it and really demonstrate that we have patterns and components implemented in our systems, right? So here, let me present you an example of a case study. So this is about a large telecom customer, right? They had a legacy application in place, and they were running stores across the country, and they used to get new customers. They used to get payment from existing customers. And what they found was their fraud detection was post-facto. Right, fraud detection in payments, right? Customer comes and pays some money, and later, after a day or so, when batch processes run, you find that so many transactions are fraudulent or potentially fraudulent. With that, what you do is you have to call, you have to have a customer service department which calls the bank or which calls the customer to figure out what happened. And some of them turned out to be real fraudulent cases which you have to write off, right? You have to all follow through some legal procedures. And when with digital happening, the question was, hey, how can we create an application which is really scalable, which is cloud native, microservices based, and also can we bring in real time detection of fraud so that the store manager can get a clear yes or no on whether a transaction has to be passed or failed, right? So we brought this into, this is about another way of creating desirability, that is understanding the customer's problem and giving a solution as early as we can, right? Being fast and predictable, fast, frequent and predictable, right? It's not enough if we understand the customer's problem, right? It's not enough if we provide a solution, right? We have to be fast, frequent and predictable. So that is the case. So we built a cloud native application. It integrates with the external credit agency and other services. Typically, these credit agency systems are heritage systems with the slow response time and all that. We created this real-time fraud assessment system, which pings or which sends a message to these credit agencies and gets a message back to really validate whether a customer is worthy and if the transaction is good to be considered as valid. A scalable architecture, microservices-based implementation. We deployed agile coaching to bring the essence of being fast, frequent, and predictable in our teams, and CI/CD, continuous integration and continuous deployment. So now this system, we have seen tangible financial outcomes, and also it can scale up to 70,000 transactions per week. These are like really enrolling a customer, receiving payment, and so on. It's not like a frequent flight ticket booking or banking transactions. So the volume is a big volume for this industry, and also 99.9% availability, which really relieved the store managers from their frustration. They started liking it. And that really added quality of work life to them. So this is an example of how we build systems that help in enhancing desirability from the angle of solving problems, being fast, frequent, and predictable. Again, I have given this PDF link, which will have a detailed story narrated in the case study template. Go through it. Now the third one, right? Third one is about very, very important. Third one is very important. It's about inclusion, relationships, retrospectives, and results. This is about understanding success, critical stakeholders. This is about moving beyond your scrum roles or safe roles, and identifying success critical stakeholders and involving them and bringing them into your program or project. Inclusive sprint and release retrospectives, meaning involving success critical stakeholders in those retrospectives, and also cross-functional teams with SMEs from business, where you plant them in your project in such a way that they become your role models, that they become your influencers in increasing adoption, commitment, reliability, and predictability. You know, ensuring commitment, reliability, and predictability, so you become a credible team. People know that you walk the talk, and you are going to show success in the project, right? So in one of our engagements, it was a large engagement. It was for a very unique customer, one of the top five consulting firms in the world. We were given the responsibility of creating and deploying their audit system as a product. So these are audits conducted by very experienced auditors throughout the world, and they involve in audits of companies which are either local to a country or they are global, right? Global organizations. So these audits happen for multiple weeks in multiple locations, then evidences, report, all that created final findings and assessment or audit reports is present. So it's a time consuming process. The goal was to productize. The goal was to productize in such a way that all auditors start using the product. And also, we wanted to have a mobile interface so that if an auditor is traveling, can go through the audit plan, days plan, or weeks plan, or months plan, and look at what's going on and do some offline activities, do some online activities. It was a tall order, right? We figured out, we worked with the customer, figured out, and one best thing that happened was some of the practicing auditors or practicing SMEs from their groups, we identified them and brought them into this program, brought them as part of cross-functional teams. So they played the role of business analyst. They worked with the product owner in grooming, prioritizing the backlog, grooming user stories. They underwent product management training program, product ownership lessons. And then even before a sprint review, they would tell whether a user story is going to be accepted or not. And when there was a plan to do a large demo, right, before a significant release, in front of all these auditors, these were the SMEs who stood to demonstrate the product. So the auditors are seeing these SMEs front-ending and showing them the product that they have developed. It's like, you know, they were directly influencing, and the adoption rate skyrocketed and it became a successful product. So this is about inclusion, relationship, retrospectives, and the sales. Sometimes when products are developed within an IT team and then taken to business, it becomes real. A tall order to get the product accepted. It fails to go viral. It undergoes a lot of rework and all that happens. So that is a real life case study. And this is one more, right? Leading insurers digital journey, which this is an example of how we operate. Our engagement started with a small project and it scaled to a large scale transformation journey. Multiple service lines or business lines moved far from the lowermost level of pricing models to an outcome based approach. We created synergy between IT and business, focus on consulting and execution, strong relationships. So the point I'm making is, these are equally important elements when you're developing a product, when you're working on a transformative initiatives to make your product desirable. Because what you're going to do is through these, inclusion, relationship, retrospectives, and results, you're going to get signs on how you're moving, how you're progressing, right? You don't get signals just by looking at your sprint and velocity. You get multiple valuable signals, and you have an opportunity to course correct and make your product viral. And this program resulted in 20% total cost of ownership reduction across IT landscape with more than 55 million savings. Right? It's $55 million savings. It's a significant saving for a large insurance company. And this would not have happened with these elements, inclusion, relationships, retrospective, and results. And the fourth one is attention to internal and external quality. So sometimes we start focusing more on external quality, which is about user experience and are there any defects, black box defects, is every feature working well or not. It's very important to focus on internal qualities or quality as well. It's about your architecture, your design, your code. Follow a KPI-driven architecture design quality approach, which is very important, right? You don't feel qualitatively better about your architecture and design. You also look at those design or architecture specific metrics. For example, coupling, cohesion, and so on. Focus on non-functional requirements. Do not allow that to be a reactive step or a separate stage later. In every sprint, you can bring those elements and proactively test and make sure that you're within the boundaries, right? And continuous everything, continuous testing, continuous learning, continuous builds, and wherever you can do continuous practice that, mainly in order to improve external and internal quality. It's also about continuous demo, continuous involvement of end users, usability experiments, and so on. Feedback loops and perpetual learning. So learning can happen daily. That's what extreme programming says, right? Extreme programming talks about daily retrospectives or daily reflection of how things are happening in a team. Feedback loops and perpetual learning can happen daily, day in and day out. It need not wait for a retrospective, because I know how challenging retrospectives are when we work on a tight project. This is how we create a culture, right, around building internal and external quality, and also put a solid foundation for perpetual learning. So let me support it with a case study, right? We wanted to redefine the mobile banking customer experience, because mobiles were becoming popular, smartphones and other competitors coming into mobile banking space. This customer had a mobile banking app and platform, but it was a little outdated, slow, and it was not getting year-on-year increase in number of customers who are adopting. So we wanted to create a personalized digital banking experience so that it works on both Android and iOS, both on Apple phones and iPads. Very thorough focus on internal external quality in terms of scalability, security, speed, availability, and also user experience, agile lifecycle with DevOps practices and innovation. We brought in a lot of innovation in terms of security, in terms of we brought in machine language to promote facial recognition and so on and so forth. All these are illustrated in this PDF. You can go through it later. So this is an example of how you bring that kind of an experience to make a product viral. So the proof is 3.5 million active users and no traffic doubled within a year from 30 to 65%. Not only that, it got an industry award among top three well-known mobile in an industry-wide study. A position among the top three, which is a very noteworthy recognition. And this shows what kind of steps and approach or considerations can help us move our digital products in that direction. So with that note, the fifth one, right? This is the fifth and final one. It's about the attitude of elegance, tenacity, and courage. And attitude of elegance is always about not doing the best thing, doing the elegant thing, and the courage to embrace modern technologies, all that. And then tenacity is about how strong you are, right? And there is a difference between tenacity and courage. Courage is how courageous you are in a specific situation. Tenacity is when you are going through testing times, how strong you are, how are you going to hold your feet together and stand and face the situation. Definitely, the elements are, one is product centricity, which brings a lot of elegance to the way you build. Even when we build digital applications, build it as a product, make it configurable, make it scalable, make sure that it can be swiftly expanded to new geographies and see if there is a potential for new business models. And autonomy and fail fast, fail early culture, which is about the courage. Courage to fail fast and learn and fail early. Very important. Rewards and recognition and result oriented. Come what may, do not let your focus go away from appreciating team members and focusing on end results, and also create a community-based network, which really changes your hierarchical-based systems and the delays you face. It creates more social, high-touch environment, which enhances the sense of belonging to all engineers in your project. That helps bring the right elements into the product you're building. So if you don't have these, will we have any negative impact? Definitely. If you don't have product centricity, if you don't have fail fast, fail early, if you don't have result orientation, rewards recognition, or community-based network, even imagine what kind of negative impacts or consequences we may have. So this is a very important consideration. And now with that note, let us see one more case, right? It's a mobile channel for customer engagement. It sparked 150% growth in use, right? It kind of really hooked the customers. We aligned with the business KPIs, which one of the business KPI was to increase growth in use by 1.5x, and created continuous improvement as part of the whole thing, and aligned with those business KPIs, agile and cross-functional teams. This app, the rating rose from 4.5, rose to 4.5 from 3.3 in Google Play Store, and 4.5 from 3.3 in Apple Store as well. So this is a significant, recognition of the way people adopted it. This story is illustrated in the PDF given here. So this shows us that, you know, it is important, right? When we design something, we have to mean product centricity. We have to design it as a product. It's not just something which is going to stay with a limited set of users. And also giving autonomy to the team and allow them to fail fast, allow them to fail early and learn quickly, and create communities-based network which that can focus on results, that flattens the hierarchy, and you have like-minded people and leaders from whom the team members can learn from. That marks a real difference. And here you go. If you look at a full view of those five things, to enhance desirability, empathy and experimentation, being fast, frequent, and predictable, inclusion, relationships, retrospectives, and results, attention to internal, external quality, and attitude of elegance, tenacity, and courage. And all these are explained in this PDF, which is a white paper, about 10 or 12 pages. Feel free. It's available in public for download and read. And even in this paper, you will have a greater detail of those case studies. Please go through. And finally, I want to register some important thoughts. One is, when I was researching on this topic, I found that several projects failed. And we keep hearing about failed projects from time and again. We see in articles, and there are repositories of case studies of such failed projects. And one thing they have in common, right, at least some of the recently failed projects, recent 2 or 3 years, is the absence of focus on desirability. I know one, a large healthcare project failed. We know about it, right? A huge investment went in, and the absence of focus on desirability. Maybe customers of certain age group, they did not like it. They did not want to do it. There are several steps involved in doing it. Very basic things, right? These were missed, and it became a failure. So it is again and again hitting as, yes, this is an important topic, frequently talked about, but it has to be paid attention to, right? Who can pay attention to it? It is this community, right? The community that practices agile, DevOps, and modern engineering. And it is an opportunity to course correct, even if your project is in a in flight mode and deliver right products to begin with. There's no, it's not too late. You start a new project, take a fresh look, and consider these five considerations, which will help you. And more than that, right, to begin with, is all about how do we bring this mindset? How do we nurture the right talent, culture, and mindset? How do we bring that in our teams? And second is, how do we balance this, right? Instead of, we need to enable the workforce, and we need to have enough hands-on experiments. It's not hands-on experiment, is not just about implementing a technical use case or a business use case. How do we register this when we enable our teams, right? How do we make them understand this important aspect? And also, how do we promote continuous learning and operational improvements? Ongoing improvements for tangible business outcomes. So these are collectively certain steps one can consider, look into as we move forward and start triggering some initiatives. Feel free to reach out to me if you have any questions, even at a later stage. Thank you for being attentive.